The following program is brought to you free of charge by the sponsorship of Novus Ordo Watch. See for yourself that the Church of the Second Vatican Council is not in fact the Catholic Church of the Ages. Go to NovusOrdoWatch.org. That's NovusOrdoWatch.org.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Francis Watch on member-supported Restoration Radio. I'm your host, Stephen Heiner, and joining me as always are His Excellency Bishop Donald Sanborn and Father Anthony Chicotta. Your Excellency, Father, thank you for joining us.
Nice to be here again. Very happy to be here as usual, Stephen.
So, Your Excellency and Father, it's hard to know where to begin on this trip to Mexico. He managed to say all sorts of things. It's Super Tuesday in the United States, as far as I'm concerned. So why don't we start with Donald Trump and the accusation that Trump is not a real Christian? Someone might say, Your Excellency, Francis is right. Look at that. He's calling Donald Trump not a Christian. He's standing up for Catholicism.
That comment I heard on that whole thing was that they accused Trump of wanting to make the Vatican great. Again, and I'm all for that. it's an absurd accusation. And who is he? I mean, he denies the existence of God. He says God does not exist. He says that there's no Catholic God. And who is he to call someone a Christian or not? And who is he to judge? And he lives in the biggest walled city, probably, or the city with the biggest wall in the whole world. So he should talk about walls. If you get around to the back of the Vatican, the walls, they look like a mountain. They were built in the Middle Ages. So, but I don't want to say that too much because he might get in his head to tear them all down. But in any case, it's just an absurd. I mean, it shows again his stupidity to say something like that. I mean, if you wanted to say, I don't agree with Mr. Trump's approach to the immigration problem, well, that's his business. But the to say that somebody is not a Christian who builds walls and not bridges. So what, are we supposed to build bridges for them to come across the Rio Grande and just invade our country? You know, and this is the one, by the way, who said to Europe, oh, you have to bring in all the refugees. Everybody's got to come in. And told the parish priest to each take one family. And the Vatican would take two. The Vatican, which could probably buy half of Rome for apartment houses and other things, they would take two families. You know? And you could put up 100 families in that apostolic palace that he doesn't even live in. And, you know, so he, again, this stupidity, absurdity, hypocrisy by, on the one hand, saying, who am I to judge? But then, you know, some man that he never even met, he's going to say he's not a Christian.
What occurred to me is about the Vatican walls and bridges is that what he could do is knock down the Vatican walls and bring in all the gypsies who live on the bridge at the Castle San Angelo and put them all in his backyard.
Yes. That would be most appropriate.
It's a typical Bergoglio thing.
Yes.
Because what defines being a Christian is not the true concept of faith, but is some sort of a social action.
Yes.
And that if you are good to immigrants, if you give them a free pass across the Rio Grande, that is what designates you as a true Christian. Yes, not doctrine, profession of the faith, anything like that. No, it's social action. And essentially he's saying that he has apostatized from Christianity. He's calling him an apostate. He says, you're not a Christian. That means he's virtually excommunicating him. And, you know, this is the person that says, you know, we shouldn't, you know, judge, we shouldn't do anything nasty. But he reserved it for his enemies very, very forcefully.
For the enemies of the social program.
Yes.
And then the other thing that I just can't resist pointing out is the whole idea is so 60s. That whole idea of build bridges instead of walls.
Yes.
I mean, how many times did we hear that?
I remember seeing things like that on felt banners in those Novgorod chapels.
Yeah. So his brain, such as it is sort of stuck in gear in the 60s with those felt banner ideas. I don't know if they do that. Do they do that anymore in the Novus Ordo Church? Do they do that when you're in their felt banners with idiotic things on them, flowers?
They did in my time, Father, and Your Excellency, but you have to keep in mind, that was back in the aughties. You know, I haven't been in a Novus Ordo Church in a long time, so I can't really speak to that. I have to say, though, on the walls issue of the Vatican, I just see it as a practical preventative measure to stop the Vatican from being overwhelmed by hordes of Asian tourists. I think you kind of have to keep the wall in place for now.
They got to get those pictures.
Right. You know, the gypsies are nothing compared to the fearsome hordes of Asian tourists. Remember, they are related to Genghis Khan. Now, in relation to this Mexico trip, in addition to quote-unquote excommunicating Donald Trump, we also got some comments on contraception, a la Ratzinger and quote-unquote exceptions to the rule. The quote, the translated from the Vatican website transcript of the interview was read as such. Abortion is not the lesser of two evils. It is a crime. It is to throw someone out in order to save another. That's what the mafia does. It is a crime, an absolute evil. On the quote-unquote lesser evil, avoiding pregnancy, we are speaking in terms of the conflict between the fifth and sixth commandment. Paul VI, a great man, in a difficult situation in Africa, permitted nuns to use contraceptives in case of rape. Don't confuse the evil of avoiding pregnancy by itself with abortion. Abortion is not a theological problem. It is a human problem. It is a medical problem.
Bishop Sanborn, it's an advantage being in the same room doing this, because I think he's sort of nodding and his eyes are sort of going around in a circle.
Oh, there's so much wrong with that one statement. I don't know where to begin about it.
Well, it's good that you're there, Father Chicana, because you could catch him if he falls out of his chair.
I had to have him try to explain to me about this my jaw dropped with the fifth and sixth commandments. I couldn't figure out what connection Bergoglio was making.
Yeah, he said that, and maybe it was in the next paragraph or something, but he says that the fifth and sixth commandment are in conflict. And so Father said, what does he mean by that? I said, well, the fifth commandment says thou shalt not kill. So that means you can't do an abortion. The sixth commandment says thou shalt not commit adultery, so that means you can't have birth control. See, but if you don't use contraception, then you're killing somebody with the Zika virus. So therefore, the sixth and the fifth commandments are in conflict there, as if they're in conflict in God's mind, as if there is no possible resolution of those two things that, you know, in the mind of God that we must respect. Notice that no one ever brought up the idea of abstaining, that maybe if you have a communicable disease, that you stay away from your spouse until the disease passes. Notice that that has never been brought up. And that was the way in which it was treated in the past, that if you had any communicable disease, that was a reason not to approach your spouse. See?
because you obviously you can't disobey either commandment, the fifth or the sixth. All right? And but to say that on the one hand abortion is intrinsically evil, that's essentially what he's saying. But then he says that, well, preventing it, conception is not intrinsically evil. That means it's intrinsically good. You see, because if it's not intrinsically evil, it then it is intrinsically good, and it becomes evil only by circumstance. This is standard moral theology. And therefore, it's just some circumstance that makes it evil. That's why Lombardi said, usually, whose job it is usually to fix him up. He made it worse. He said that you can use artificial birth control with discernment. In other words, you need some sort of, you know, good reason to use that.
No, it's just that only now when Bishop Sanborn explained it, he explained it to me twice before, what the sort of non-reasoning process of Bergoglio was, and I still didn't get exactly what he's getting at. Now I'm like, it's so goofy. The jaw, you know, my jaw hits the floor. It surprises the cat sitting here.
Listening carefully.
Yeah. Someone would be so stupid to say something like that. It's absolutely astounding. And as you say, somehow there's a conflict when you go from number five to number six on the stone tablets.
Yes.
These are colliding.
It's as if there's a conflict in the very will of God. To say that those are conflicting commandments, but that has never been said by anybody in the history of the church, that two commandments could possibly conflict. Both commandments must be observed, and absolutely.
The implication is that you have conflicting commandments, and then God leaves it to you to figure out.
Yes.
Which is,
We should point out that it was Ratzinger who permitted artificial birth control back in 2013, and he did it for the same reason that it's permitted, because there is this idea of helping the other person if you use artificial birth control, that you will not communicate AIDS in that case. And this is for Africa. And so he set down all of the rules. All of the theology for this, that it is justified when there is some serious reason. And that means that artificial birth control is not evil in itself. That is contrary to the definition of Pius XI in Casti Connubii, who said that we proclaim, and then he said that artificial birth control is evil, intrinsically evil, he said. So that qualifies for heresy. And it is against the universal ordinary magisterium of the church, which one of the members of the fraternity of St. Peter said that this is against the ordinary magisterium of the church, what Bergoglio said, and he instructed his people to simply ignore it. Just ignore it. So that would be like ignoring some enormous pile of garbage in the room that is stinking. It's like in the room and we don't talk about it. It's recognize and resist. Well, now it's recognize and ignore. That's their approach to it.
Doesn't this also violate the principle of the double effect, Your Excellency?
No, it has nothing to do with double effect. You have two things that are intrinsically evil. One is an abortion. The other is artificial birth control, right? It's also wrong to communicate diseases in sexual intercourse. You know, if a person has syphilis, for example, they have to stay away from each other because you can't communicate to the child the syphilitic infection. See, So all of the there's really no application of double effect here at all. It's two commandments that must be observed, and the way they are observed is by abstinence.
And never is that you never see that word.
No, that is a taboo. to even mention the word abstinence. And in this case, with the Zika virus, it would only be for a time because it comes and goes. So it's not as if you're saying forever, although it, in certain cases it is forever, if it's an incurable disease. But in this case, it might be a few weeks. You know, so it's just a complete breakdown of Catholic morality. He's a heretic for saying it, and the recognized and resistance people have a credibility now that is in absolute ruin. You can't just ignore that.
Well, and the last vestiges of the old church that these people managed to hang on to were connected with sexual morality in some way or another. And that was basically what defined you as being a conservative, because you accepted all of the new principles of Vatican II, the new teachings of the church, religious liberty, ecumenism, all that other stuff. And the last thing left to the so-called conservatives was the aspect of law that had to do with sex. But now even that is gone with this latest pronouncement. How can you defend him anymore? I don't see how you can do it.
No, and I just add this too, that all of the, let's call it, the rationale of artificial birth control leads to abortion, because artificial birth control says you, not God, has control over the conception of human beings. Once you posit that principle, that human beings have control over their own conception and their own generation, then abortion becomes legitimate, because after all, it's in the mother's womb. She has the control over her conceptions and her generations. And therefore, it justifies the principle of abortion. That's why abortion exists, because contraception exists. They go hand in hand.
Well, from one heresy to another, Your Excellency and Father, earlier last month, on February the 5th, the gospel reading for that day, I don't know what feast it was in the Novus Ordo sect, but it was from St. Mark, chapter 6, verses 14 through 29, and specifically he was looking at verses 1 through 6, Matthew 11, which was related, but not from that exact passage. And it reads, "And it came to pass, when Jesus had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples, he passed from thence to teach and preach in their cities. Now when John had heard in prison the works of Christ, sending two of his disciples, he said to him, Art thou he that art to come, or look we for another? And Jesus, making answer, said to them, Go and relate to John what you have heard and seen. The blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead rise again, the poor have the gospel preached to them, and blessed is he that shall not be scandalized in me. Now, Francis commented on this, saying that he thought that St. John wasn't sure whether our Lord was actually the Messiah, and the text is from the Vatican Radio website, took his congregation beyond the text of the gospel, inviting them to enter into John's cell to look into the soul of the voice crying out in the desert of the one who baptized the crowds in the name of him who was to come, the one who was now weighed down not only by the iron chains that bound him in his prison, but by the shackles of some doubt, despite everything. But he also suffered in prison, let us say the word, the interior torture of doubt. But maybe I made a mistake? The Messiah is not how I imagined the Messiah would be. And he invited his disciples to ask Jesus, but tell us the truth. Are you he who is to come? Because that doubt made him suffer. Was I mistaken in proclaiming someone who isn't who I thought? The suffering, the interior solitude of this man, I, on the other hand, must diminish, but diminish thus in soul, in body, in everything." Diminishment is the word that comes to mind, Your Excellency. How would you...
Something else something else comes to mind, because when you say at the beginning of the Vatican Radio comment that he took the congregation beyond the text of the gospel, all I could think of is that cartoon strip in the paper about 25 years ago, Beyond the Far Side. And because the comments on this are so crazy.
Shall we review St. John the Baptist a little bit? he was conceived miraculously in the womb of Elizabeth, who was sterile and in old age, right? And so by the power of God. And then when Our Blessed Lady went to see St. Elizabeth, he leapt for joy in the womb of St. Elizabeth, all right, for the presence of Christ in the womb of Our Blessed Lady. Then when they went to circumcise him, the father wanted to call him, the mother wanted to call him Zachary after his father, but the father said, no, he shall be called John. But he had been muted by the angel Gabriel precisely because of his doubts. And so he could say nothing until the circumcision, from the conception to the circumcision. He was muted. He could not speak. And he wrote on a chalkboard, a little chalkboard, John is his name. And then his tongue was loosed, and he said the Benedictus, what the church calls the Benedictus, blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel. And that describes the mission of St. John the Baptist to point out the Messiah. All right, so all of these supernatural things are taking place. Then the boy, at an early age, goes out into the desert and eats all of these, you know, pretty disgusting things, and in order to do penance and to show himself as penitential, totally aware of his mission to point out the Messiah. And then the Pharisees come and ask him, are you the Messiah? He says, no. Are you Elias? No. All right. And then when our Lord appears, he points his finger at him and says, behold, the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Pointing out the Messiah to everyone. All right. Then he baptizes our blessed Lord a little afterwards, and the sky opens up and the Holy Ghost comes down in the form of a dove, and God speaks, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear ye him. All right? So then St. John the Baptist recedes, and our Lord, of course, becomes great in the eyes of men. And the reason why he's in prison is not because he pointed out the Messiah. I mean, maybe he should open up his Bible. But the reason that he's in prison is because he denounced the false marriage of Herod, right? Not the Herod the baby killer, but his grandson, who was the Herod who ended up involved in the Passion. He married his brother's wife, who his brother died, and that was against the law. And he denounced that marriage, and that was the reason why he was in prison. It had nothing to do with pointing out the Messiah. And the traditional interpretation of why he told his disciples to go and ask our Lord that question was to evoke from our Lord the precise answer that our Lord gave. And that was to convince his disciples, by quoting the prophecies of Isaiah, that he was the true Messiah. He wanted to bring it out for the sake of his disciples. But he had no doubt. That would be to doubt the faith. I mean, how could a person like that have any doubt, given all of the supernatural interventions in his life, that his whole life is given over from the time that he was a young child, given over to the pointing out of the Messiah, that how could he have any doubt? It tells me that he's got a lot of doubt. That doubt, he talks about doubt as if it were some sort of noble thing there. You know, he has doubts and he's got these tortures. And, I think he's beyond doubt. Personally, I don't think the man believes in God. That's my personal belief about Bergoglio. But he treats doubt as if, you see, you shouldn't feel so bad if you're doubting the faith, because look at John the Baptist. He doubted it too. But it is one more slap in the face, a blasphemous slap against St. John the Baptist, and also a profession of ignorance concerning Holy Scripture, and also a profession of disbelief and unbelief with regard to the supernatural events in St. John the Baptist's life.
I agree with Father Chicada's assessment. I think it was beyond the text of the gospel, definitely to the far side in that interpretation.
And these are the people who wanted to make religion more scriptural. And that's what I kept on thinking when Bishop Sanborn was recounting all of this, that that's what we're told time and time again, that this big shift in as a result of Vatican II, we were going to really get the kernel of Scripture. Well, we don't get the kernel of anything here.
There's a lot of corny stuff.
Yeah.
No, I was going to say, maybe Colonel Sanders.
that's about it.
The next thing I'd like to look at, Your Excellency and Father, is something that's happening in Great Britain, which is the Year of Mercy bus. I don't know if our listeners have had a chance to read this. It was reported in the Catholic Herald, which is one of the Novus Ordo papers of record. And it's by the Diocese of Salford. And it's a double-decker bus that's going to tour parts of Greater Manchester and Lancashire. And there's going to be priests on board available to hear confessions. They're going to be able to give blessings or just have a simple chat, quote-unquote. There will also be music and young volunteers distributing leaflets to passers-by. Bishop John Arnold of Salford said, "The Mercy Bus is a way of reaching out to people who might not otherwise have contact with the church. We are going to them rather than expecting them to come to us." Well, you know, maybe you could get a bus down there in Florida, Your Excellency, pack up the seminary and go down, distribute leaflets, follow Novus Ordo Watch's planned Year of Condemnation, and you could hand out lots of condemnations to people.
It's another gimmick. What's the point? So corny. The whole idea of doing something like that, and what's the point with this missionaries of mercy anyway? What are these people supposed to do?
Well, they're supposed to tell people who are living in adultery that it's okay if they carry on the way they do, and all sorts of other things that the year of mercy. And they would do better to show up at a fitness gym with that than run around England. Who's going to come out of their houses? If they were selling ice cream, they might do a little better. But I mean, England is a place that is virtually religionless. And who is going to, come out and be excited about a bus coming through? Or show up at the stock exchange or something. I mean, that's what people are really interested in. It's just so stupid. I think it will be a tremendous flop. I don't think anybody will pay much attention to it.
There's the character of the English who doesn't lend itself to stuff like this. I mean, it might work in Mexico.
Yes.
But, I mean, the British are so laid back and diffident about anything like this. It's just a crazy PR stuff.
Well, I suppose there's also... Right, well, I mean, there's the risk of getting into an accident and you get hit by the bus of mercy. I mean, I don't know what happens then. I mean, you're definitely not waiting for people to come to you, I guess. You're bringing the faith to them. Well, I guess we'll leave the mercy bus in our rearview mirror, Your Excellency and Father. We'll move on to hugging, I would say, both of the earth and of the Russian Orthodox. And we'll start with the earth hugging. This is yet another video that Francis has released to try to keep up with Father Chicada. And it's about care for creation. And I don't know if either of you had a chance to see this video.
Well, I saw it, and it's the usual earth worship type of thing. And they actually have some fellow who is very thoughtfully putting a piece of paper into a recycling bin, which, again, the idea is so trite and so goofy, and so much on the level of this world and the level of material things and the level of the modern leftist program. It's almost like a parody. But he takes this business quite seriously, that there's some sort of a religious obligation. So we had ecumenism last month, and we have the recycling guy this month. So, it's another step down, another step away from religion into the religion of this world.
Yeah, it's... More of the same. I mean, it's from the 19th century, what they call social gospel. The purpose of the church is not to uplift people to contemplation of God and to obey the commandments. The purpose of the church is to make life on this earth better. And you can see that theme in Gaudium et Spes, where the church gets on the bandwagon of making the earth a better place to live. And so, you know, it's a constant theme with him. I mean, does he ever really talk about God? Does he ever say anything that is edifying, spiritually edifying? Isn't it always something about peace or tree hugging or some, you know, walls and building bridges? I mean, he just pokes his nose into all of these left-wing projects for the world to make the world a better place to live. So he has transformed the Catholic religion into a social gospel.
Yeah. And I don't know if there's any significance in this, but after what they called the Pope video, which had his latest message, the next thing that came up on YouTube is Jesuit Order Exposed 666 Mark of the Beast Final Warning.
Well, that algorithm's really smart, Father. It picks out those matching videos. Right.
The communists. And communists, right. Their religion is humanity. And he is following suit. You know, he's doing exactly what he should be doing as a good communist.
Yeah, I was struck by, there was a particular line in the video in which he's speaking of our common home, Earth. You know, that we need to take care of this thing. And again, I both of you have made this point in previous episodes. So the Catholic position is not that we need to treat the planet like trash, but the point is that we have stewardship, we have guardianship, but this is all passing. This is going to go away, and we should be focused on building the kingdom of Christ within ourselves, not worrying about saving the planet. And there's a complete distraction here. You both said this before in the past, but the video sort of struck when he was speaking about it. It seemed to me there's something, you said earlier, Your Excellency, you don't think that he believes in God. I think he definitely believes in saving the planet. I mean, I think that's his big thing.
It's a religion substitute. It's what all the leftists do. They have religion substitutes. And it could be even things that are noble in themselves, like pancreatic cancer or breast cancer. You know, they give to all of these things, or building hospital wings. Those things are good in themselves. But it's the way it is done, as if there is no God, and our God is to make life better here and to overcome death by medicine. See, that's the idea behind all of that humanistic charity. And remember, Pius X said, called a monstrous error, a charity without faith. He said that is what is facing us today, is a charity without faith. And that's exactly what Bergoglio is giving for.
Well, as I said, we're going to move from hugging trees to hugging Russian patriarchs. In a news story, it was said on February the 8th, we must build bridges, not walls, because they aid the cause of peace. I want I wanted to meet and embrace my Orthodox brothers again. And then he goes on to speak about migrants. And Russia Today also had some coverage on this as relation of the current sanctions on Russia, that this could be sort of a diplomatic play by Francis to bring Russia back into the conversation after after the sanctions from the Ukrainian intervention. What do you see in this, Your Excellency and Father?
Well, it's more of the same. It's more of the ecumenical nonsense. But I thought it was significant that they ended up meeting in Cuba under the aegis of Raul Castro, Fidel's brother. And this was the circumstance under which Kirill, who was supposed to have been a KGB agent or a KGB stooge, when the Soviet Union still existed, in fact, it was done in Cuba. So that I thought was significant. The Russian patriarch, the Patriarch of Moscow, historically didn't ever want to have anything to do with the Pope because he had the idea, the patriarchs had the idea that there was no room in their religion for ecumenism because they believed that their religion was the one true religion. Why should they go and meet with someone who represented the false Roman religion? So at least at one point they had the idea that that you're supposed to have one religion that God expects you to adhere to. But apparently that's gone as well. I saw somewhere else, trying to find it now, that he was also Kirill in one of the statements that one of the paragraphs in the statement that he signed with Bergoglio, in effect, sort of gave away the story in the Ukraine, that the Ukrainian Catholics who had joined the Catholic Church, I think, come back from schism in the Union of Brest-Litovsk or something in the 1600s, that and became known as Uniates. So the movement to join the Roman Catholic Church was referred to as Uniatism. So Bergoglio signed a statement with Kirill, saying that, well, Uniatism is now not the way to go, that trying to convert people is not really the way to go. And the Ukrainians felt sold out by him because they had been persecuted by the Russian Orthodox in the Ukraine precisely because they were Uniates and they had united themselves in the 17th century to the authority of the Pope. So, in effect, Bergoglio gave away the store ecumenically there for the sake of meeting with this bearded KGB agent.
Yes, and those Eastern Europeans suffered a great deal at the hands of the Tsar and the Russian Orthodox, which is a branch of the Tsarist government, suffered a great deal. Had their churches taken away. And, it was centuries of suffering and strife. And for him to, in one sentence, say, well, that was all wrong, that was the wrong approach, is to just say that all of those people who suffered at least white martyrdoms for their faith and for their loyalty to the Pope and for Uniatism, to be united to the Pope, well, that was just a lot of nonsense. But he said in the past, proselytism is all nonsense. It's the same principle that trying to propose the Catholic Church as the one true church is something that we should not do.
With that, we'll move on to our final segment today, Your Excellency and Father, which is Randomalia, which we'll have just a couple news items that are a bit off the beaten path, if we weren't already off the beaten path. And the first is that there's an official olive oil of the Year of Mercy. So we may see some other licensed products coming out for the Year of Mercy. You know, All those other popes really missed out on all those endorsement possibilities when they had jubilee years back in the day.
I hear that the patriarch Kirill likes Rolex watches, so maybe there's a Rolex watch of the Year of Mercy, something like that.
It could be they're competing for an endorsement there. And speaking of endorsements, there's a soccer match for peace. Father Chicada, you were telling me in the pre-show that you were struck by a couple of comments from the news story for this.
Normally something like this, the heading match, a soccer match for peace, so for goal, you know, would be something that I would kind of skip over. But when I looked at this, sort of made a big deal of the soccer match for peace, different soccer stars, people that I've never heard of, thank heaven. And they were part of the match for peace. And he said that one of the definitions of the Pope is to be the servant of the servants of God. That's why I'm here. That's why I agreed to come, Francis said, explaining that the intent of the game isn't proselytization. Okay, but the good of the human person. Quote, I want to be very clear. What matters here is the human person. Man and woman must be the center. There we go back to that theme again. And the 60s theme of Paul VI, and the integral humanism and all this other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And that the
cult of man.
The cult of man, we have the cult of man. Above all, and he's it keeps on coming up with Bergoglio, probably because he doesn't believe in God.
Yeah, I don't think he believes in God. What is the good of man and woman except to teach to that they embrace the Catholic faith and that they go to heaven? What is the good? He says the good. What good is that? What good is he referring to? Except the good that proselytism brings to you. Namely, the gospel. Blessed are the feet of those, you know, who preach the gospel. That's what it says in sacred scripture. The command, the grand commission to the apostles to preach the gospel for all that. That is the good of the church. That is the good. The primary and most fundamental good is to convert people to the Catholic faith, to bring them into the mystical body of Christ, so that they have the possibility of going to heaven. What good is he talking about? You know, the that they can run and they can hit a ball with their heads? Well, what is the good? It's all pagan. This is all still pagan.
Well, it's a substitute religion, again, because the religion of sport is... Bishop Dolan and I did a show on that for you, I think, at one point, and it's another religion substitute. That you know, at one point, the sport was simply something you did for a little bit of fun, but the whole way in which it is developed now, it is a major cultural and a major human activity throughout the world because of the because of modern communications and marketing, et cetera. So this is a substitute for it. Bergoglio gets involved because it's part of the religion of humanity. I mean, it's one thing to have a soccer club or as we had in the old days, a CYO basketball team where Catholics, Catholic kids could get together to do sports for fun and for some sort of legitimate recreation, but what he's talking about now on the level of professional sport is actually a religion, which I suppose is the way that he wants it if man is the center of everything.
Well, I figure, Father, you've got the height to probably have been a pretty good basketball player in your CYO days, unlike me. I'm not tall enough, unfortunately. I remember being really dismayed, maybe one of the early times I'd met Bishop Dolan, and we talked about Super Bowl Sunday and there being a noticeable diminishment of people in the pews on Super Bowl Sunday. And I remember just being astonished by by that. I was a young and naive trad at the time. I really didn't know, but marketing books, they talk about the fact that the NFL has managed to brand an entire day of the week. And I think it probably tells you exactly where our civilization is.
Yes, and the older books mention major sports events as a violation of Sunday. The older catechisms mention that. Major sporting events as a violation of Sunday.
And you didn't have that, actually, that I remember at all.
No, you didn't. And but, yeah, everything went down the tube after Vatican II.
Well, to be fair, you're talking about major sporting events. I've heard tell of families who skip mass because Johnny has a soccer tournament on Sunday. I mean, it's not even the Super Bowl.
Johnny is going to be out of the field, or that Babs is going to be a cheerleader. I mean, that's major. That's bigger than the Super Bowl. The parents have to be there in adoration, down in adoration, falling. Before their children who are involved in sports and whatnot.
I forgot. You're actually every sporting event of your child is a major sporting event. It's something I need to file away. Before I ask His Excellency about what's going on at the seminary, Father, because we know he's going to tell us there's nothing and it's boring and it's always the same. Life up at St. Gertrude's we know is not boring. I really have to say I enjoyed your Archbishop Lefebvre Set of a Contest video. I have to say, Father, it's the best one you've done in not to say that the other ones weren't great, but probably one of the most shocking points in that video was the fact that Bishop Sanborn was ever a young priest. I you had all of these photos, and I saw all of this hair, all of this
dead
glorious
dead
hair. All of this hair on the then Father Sanborn's head, and I thought Father Dolan in that picture must have been younger than I am today. And I just thought, where did you get all these photos, Father?
In his early 20s.
Yes. It was a lot of fun going through those pictures, let me tell you. It brought back an awful lot of memories, and it was something that I've always intended to say. Bishop Sanborn had talked in 1984 after our to-do in 1983 with the society about the mentality, the internal mentality of the Society of St. Pius X, and how things sort of went in a cone in terms of two or three different factions or different camps. But it was something that needed to be said again, especially in light of the book by Salsa and Cisco, the sort of screed against state of a contism. So there was a real need to bring up, I think, all of those quotes from Archbishop Lefebvre. That is something that has been written out of the official history, as it were.
The Lefebvre canon.
Yeah, the Lefebvre canon. It's been form criticized for existence, I think. So there's a difference between the Lefebvre of faith and the Lefebvre of history.
By that same terminology, Father, they might classify yours as apocrypha.
I guess they probably would. Yeah, with their authority. But I mean, all of that stuff that I quoted from Archbishop Lefebvre was all authentic. And he did say those things that at one point, what we would now call state of a contism was not a thought crime punishable by execution or the 101 of the Ministry of Truth in the Society of St. Pius X. But, he did go back and forth. And as I do point out later in the video, even after he had had public conflicts with state of a contism, in the late 80s, he even said things that were that gave credence to the state of a contest position and hinted that he himself might become a state of a contest. So the idea that it's
demonized, and that we're somehow all the spawn of Satan, and now is absolutely crazy because they're in effect denying a part of their history for the sake of some sort of a gain now.
Yeah, so I think Father Chicada should get an Academy Award. We should have an award ceremony. And he can come down the aisle with sunglasses on.
No, I don't think that's not possible this year because the Academy Awards people have decided that they need more racial diversity, that there wasn't enough in the last Academy Awards. So I don't know what I could do. Maybe Chicago sounds Japanese, but they're not a...
They're not a minority group.
Right. Well, and you could say I was on your camera crew or something, Father. And there's a half Asian for you. You could throw that.
Yeah, that's right.
some of my best friends are Oriental.
So we know that Father Chicada has been deep in the movie production process, Your Excellency. How about you?
Well, I am still leading my bleak and dull life in the seminary, chained to a classroom and chained to preparation of classes. I'm teaching, the big course I'm teaching is church history from the time of Leo the 13th to the end of Pius the 12th reign. Which is very, very interesting, obviously, because it leads right up to our present problem. But it's a problem for me because so much is known about those frames that you have to condense it. You know, you're reading all of these books, and you have to condense it into something that is you know, they're able to digest, but it's just enormous. And but yet there's some very, very interesting things that I do read in the preparation of that class. So, but that occupies practically all my time. That's all I do is that. And next year should be easier because we go back to the early period, the first 300 years, and it's pretty much a textbook thing, and we don't know that much, thank goodness. So there's not that much to say. But I do want the seminarians to understand how Vatican II happened, and I do comment that would be too long to go into here, but it might be actually a show. You know, it all goes back to the pendulating papacy and accommodationism, and so, you know, we're seeing all of those things go back and forth in this period, and we're seeing personalities that were well known, and I think they're getting a picture of how Vatican II did in fact take place. When you have an effect like Vatican II, you have to look for a cause behind it. And it's in that period from, really, I would say, after the French Revolution right up to 1958, but especially in the 100 years before, say, from 1870 or so, from to 1958 or 62. So more or less that. But it would take me, well, I don't want to give you any ideas you might get before a show on that. But it really, you know, they're seeing a lot of the details of how Vatican II happened.
Well, you know me too well, Your Excellency.
Yes. Yes, I know nothing. I'm a complete nincompoop, and I really, my mind is blank.
I'm sorry, Father, I had forgot to ask if there's anything else going on at St. Gertrude's or SCG resources you wanted us to know about.
Well, no, it's the films. SCG resources is, we are selling a Holy Week book this coming month, a very good, a complete Holy Week book by Dom Cabral. Also, the month after that, we're going to offer book for girls and young ladies, heroines of the Old Testament, that Father Lateranta did. Our Finnish priest, who is one of the graduates of Most Holy Trinity Seminary, and a very nicely written book. So you'll be hearing
hearing more about that if you are on our mailing list.
This sounds like a commercial to me.
Yeah. Well, let me do the commercial for Bishop Sanborn, because he's beginning to do podcasts. Is going to do podcasts on this book by the tax lawyer and the investment counselor. And these will be available if you sign up on the mailing list for the Most Holy Trinity Seminary website.
Yeah, so we put in a request in our latest newsletter to send us your email address if you want to get alerts from us about various informational projects that we're doing as things happen in the church. And so if you want that, also, you know, other alerts that we see, you know, is where you might be interested in this or that, like Father Chiquetta's videos or something. We'll send out alerts for those.
Or notices that you've won the seminary lottery.
That would be a little bit later. By the way, here's some news. Our cemetery was, so maybe we'll raffle off a plot, if anybody's interested. So we can have cemetery news, too, you know, like who's been buried in this. So we did get approved. Now it has to be surveyed so that we can have each one numbered, and, you know, if somebody wants to buy one, they know what they're buying. So that's news.
And cemeteries in Florida, do they need to have gator protection? Is that gated protection down there?
Well, we do have to worry about the pigs. Those wild boars who come in and completely mess up your lawn. I mean, they go down at least 6 inches or more, and just put their snouts in looking for some sort of, you know, bugs or whatever they eat. And the cemetery could get messed up if we didn't have a fence up. So that's something we have to do in the development of the cemetery, is that.
He's limiting the occupation of it to 144,000. In case you're wondering.
So it will contain at least one of the 12 tribes. That's excellent to hear. Your Excellency. Well, as always, thank you both, Your Excellency and Father, for your time. I know we're taking you away from preparing for seminary classes tomorrow, so I will leave you to that. And thanks for giving us yet another installment of Francis Watch.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Stephen. God bless you all.
As always, if you have questions for His Excellency or Father, you can write to us, franciswatch@truerestoration.org. I want to remind you that Francis Watch is a production of member-supported Restoration Radio. All rights are reserved. Any duplication without explicit written permission is forbidden. To obtain permission, please write to mail@truerestoration.org. All of us here at member-supported Restoration Radio hope that you found this show to be informative, helpful, and beneficial to you and to your faith. In return, please think of offering a Mass, a Rosary, or even a simple Ave for our work the next time that you pray. For the Restoration, I'm Stephen Heiner. May God bless you.
This program was brought to you free of charge by the sponsorship of Novus Ordo Watch. See for yourself that the Church of the Second Vatican Council is not, in fact, the Catholic Church of the Ages. Go to novusordowatch.org. That's novusordowatch.org.